This is From His Heart with Pastor Jeff Shreve, who's in an inspiring series today entitled, We Are Family. The enemy is real and wants nothing more than to destroy your family. But the Lord wants to help you engage the attacker. Learn which weapons to have on hand and how to use them when you're fighting for your family.
Anything worthwhile in life is a fight. It takes work. It takes sweat and discipline and prayers and perseverance and determination. If it's going to matter, you're going to have to invest, and it's not going to be easy. Hey, we're in a series called We Are Family, and today we want to talk about fighting for your family. Now, to help us understand about the fight, we're going to look at Nehemiah. The book of Nehemiah is about Nehemiah gathering the people of Jerusalem to rebuild the wall. So if you have your Bible, turn to Nehemiah chapter 4. If you have trouble finding Nehemiah, just go to Psalms in the Old Testament. There are 150 of those, so you just kind of pick in the middle and you can probably find Psalms. And turn left. And you'll find Job, and you'll find Esther, and then you find Nehemiah. Nehemiah was cupbearer to the king. The king was Artaxerxes, the king of Persia. The year was 445 BC. And Nehemiah had a heart for Jerusalem. Now, he was in Persia. He was far away from Jerusalem. But he heard how bad things were because there was no wall. There was no wall around the city. Isn't that interesting? Today we're talking about walls on borders. Well, Nehemiah was concerned because there was no wall around Jerusalem. Nebuchadnezzar, when he came in and destroyed Jerusalem in 586 BC, one of the things that he did was he tore down the wall and he tore down the temple. And so when the Jews were allowed to go back after 70 years of captivity in Babylon, they were allowed. Cyrus the Great, who was the king of Persia, Persia had overtaken Babylon, he allowed the Jews to go back. And so Zerubbabel led a group of almost 50,000 Jews, and they went back. And they went back for the purpose of rebuilding Jerusalem, rebuilding the temple. And they rebuilt the temple in 515 BC, but the walls were still down. And so here we are, 445 BC. It's been 141 years since Nebuchadnezzar had destroyed the walls. They've been down. Other people had tried to rebuild, but it just never worked. And so Nehemiah, the Lord put in Nehemiah's heart, you go and you get the people to rebuild the wall. It was a massive task, a monumental task. And it was a task that was met with opposition because the surrounding neighbors of Jerusalem, the Arabs and the Samaritans and the Ammonites and the Ashdodites, they did not want to see the wall up. Why? Because a weak Jerusalem meant they could be strong. But if Jerusalem became strong again, then that was going to threaten their power base. And so the scripture says this, Nehemiah chapter 4, beginning in verse 6. So we built the wall, and the whole wall was joined together to half its height, for the people had a mind to work. Now it came about when Sanballat, who was a Samaritan leader, Tobiah, who was an Ammonite leader, the Arabs, the Ammonites, and the Ashdodites heard that the repair of the walls of Jerusalem went on and that the breaches began to be closed, they were very angry. That word angry means to blaze. I mean, there was smoke coming out of their ears. They were so mad. And it says in verse 8, and all of them conspired together to come and fight against Jerusalem and to cause a disturbance in it. But we prayed to our God, and because of them we set up a guard against them day and night. Thus in Judah it was said, the strength of the burden bearers is failing. Yet there is much rubbish, and we ourselves are unable to rebuild the wall. They're at the halfway point, and it's hard. And, you know, it was exciting when they started, and everybody had a T-shirt. We're building the wall. But now they're hit the halfway point, and it's the halfway point of the marathon, and you've hit the wall, so to speak, and you just want to quit. So the strength of the burden bearers is failing. We ourselves are unable to rebuild the wall. And our enemies said, verse 11, they will not know or see until we come among them, kill them, and put a stop to the work. And it came about when the Jews who lived near them, near the enemies, who lived near them, came and told us 10 times, they will come up against you from every place where you may turn. Then I stationed men in the lowest parts of the space between the wall, the exposed places, and I stationed the people in families with their swords, spears, and bows. They were getting ready to fight. Here's our question for today. What do we need to know about the fight for our family? What do we need to know? I want to share with you three insights from Nehemiah chapter 4. Insight number one, the enemy is real and wants to destroy your family. The enemy is real. Nehemiah and the people, they were facing a real enemy. Sanballat was a real enemy. Tobiah, a real enemy. The Ashdodites and the Ammonites and the Arabs, they were real enemies. And all those names, they kind of encompass enemies to the north, enemies to the south, enemies to the east, enemies to the west. They're just enemies all around them, just like it is today. Jerusalem sits surrounded by enemies, people that hate Israel. Well, they hated Israel back then, and they wanted to destroy Jerusalem, and they didn't want to see the walls go up. And so they were facing a real enemy, and the real enemy was ridiculing them. They were laughing at them. They were mocking them. They were threatening them with violence. They even said, we're going to come upon you and kill you if you don't stop this work. They were facing a real enemy. Now, we face a real enemy today. It's not a flesh and blood enemy like they had. Our enemy, the Bible says, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood. We don't struggle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the powers, against the world forces of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of wickedness in the heavenly places. We have a real enemy, but it's a spiritual enemy. And that spiritual enemy has a name, and his name is Satan. And there are three areas where he will come, where we need to be alert with this enemy who wants to destroy and kill and steal. Number one, we must be alert concerning our walk with God, concerning our own hearts, concerning our own walk with God. If the devil wants to destroy your family, and family is so critical and so important, outside of your relationship with God, family, there's nothing more precious than family, and the devil wants to destroy that. Now, in the Christian life, in your marriage, in your family, in your home, you got to make sure your heart is right with God. You got to be on the alert because the devil is coming, and what is he going to do to a Christian? See, to a non-Christian, he blinds the eyes of the unbelieving so they can't see the grace of God and the glory of God and who Jesus is and what it means to have a personal relationship with him. And so what do? A non-Christian ends up having religion but not a relationship with God. And they go through the motions, but they wonder, where's the power? Where's the joy? I just don't see that. It's just a bunch of drudgery. And so the devil wants to make the Christian life drudgery for the lost person. He doesn't see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ. But how about for the saved person? What does he want to do in the saved person's life? He doesn't just say, oh, well, okay, that person got saved. I guess now I just go on to somebody else because they're already saved and I can't do anything to trip them up. No. He comes at you. He comes at me. And he wants to steal our heart away. So our heart that was focused on Jesus, in love with Jesus, would start to drift away and start to find lesser loves to capture and encompass and satisfy our hearts. Hey, we must be alert concerning our walk with God. How are you doing? What's going on in here? The greatest commandment is to love the Lord with all your heart, all your soul, all your strength, and all your mind. Do you do that? Are you growing in your love for Him? Or when you're honest with yourself, have other things, lesser things, taken first place? We must be alert concerning our walk with God. Secondly, we must be alert concerning the state of our marriage. Dennis Rainey, when Debbie and I do family life conferences, we have a video of Dennis Rainey, and he always comes on, he and Barbara, and he says, you know, marriage, it's the headwaters of this thing called family. And if you want to have a great family, you have to have a great marriage. Because if the marriage gets torpedoed, then it affects everything in the family. And so he encourages couples that were at a marriage retreat, said, hey, we need to work on this thing called marriage. It is so important. You know, kids are nervous, many of them, that mom and dad aren't going to make it. That mom and dad aren't going to last. They see their friends, parents get divorced, and they wonder, is that going to happen in my home? No kid wants that. No kid wants that. I remember when Sarah was experiencing that with a friend of hers when she was in middle school, and she came home and she was upset and she was nervous, and she said, Mom and Dad, is that going to ever happen with you where you would get divorced? And we had to encourage her and just tell her, that's never going to happen. I told Debbie a long time ago, if she ever leaves me, I'm going with her. I mean, we're just not going to get divorced. We're going to work out our issues and our differences. And so we need to be alert concerning the state of our marriage. So be alert concerning your own heart and your own relationship with the Lord. Secondly, be alert concerning the state of your marriage. And thirdly, be alert concerning the condition of your children. How are they doing? Proverbs 27, verse 23. The scripture says this, know well the condition of your flocks and pay attention to your herds. That word for condition is the Hebrew word panim, which means the face. Know well the face of your flocks. Know what's going on in your kids' life. Know what's going on in their face. Spend time with your kids to know what is happening in their world. Don't just assume everything is fine because they're not telling you stuff. You need to spend time with them and quality time and quantity time so that they can feel the freedom to tell you stuff. Know well the condition of your flocks and herds. Know the face of your child. Know what's going on in them. Hey, you say, I've heard this from many parents. They're like, well, my kid doesn't let me in. No, you're not getting in here. That's why it's a fight. You got to fight. I'm not talking about you butting into where they don't even want to be around you, but you let it be known and you spend time with them and start early and start young and putting them to bed and talking to them at night. You know, kids will open up more at night. And so those kinds of things, having Bible stories together and praying together, that opens up communication. Hey, be on the alert because the enemy is out there. He wants to destroy your life. He wants to wreck and ruin your marriage. He wants to steal your kids. Second, insight from this story. The Lord is great and will help us as we fight. So look at verse 12 again. And it came about when the Jews who lived near them came and told us 10 times, they will come up against us from every place where you may turn. Nehemiah said, then I stationed men in the lowest parts of the space behind the wall and the exposed places, and I stationed the people in families with their swords, spears, and bows. And when I saw their fear, I rose and spoke to the nobles, the officials, and the rest of the people. Do not be afraid of them. Remember the Lord who is great and awesome, and fight for your brothers, your sons, your daughters, your wives, and your houses. The Lord is great and will help us as we fight. Remember who He is. He uses the word the Lord, the Adonai. Adonai is sovereign. He's the master. He's the owner. The Lord is the master of everything. He's the owner of everything. He's the sovereign king in charge of him, in charge of everything. Remember Him who's great and who's awesome. That word awesome means to be feared. And fight. See, the Lord will help us as we fight. Now, when we talk about remember the Lord, I want you to remember three things concerning the Lord and your family. Number one, remember that God wants you to have a strong and godly family. I mean, when we talk about fighting for the family, just know that God is all in that because God is all for family. That's the first thing that God created was marriage and family. Before he created the church, before he created schools, before he created government, he had Adam and Eve get married, Genesis chapter 2, and he says, be fruitful and multiply, chapter 1, and fill the earth. Hey, marriage and family, that is huge to God, and he is for marriage and family. The scripture says in Psalm 128, how blessed is everyone who fears the Lord, who walks in his ways. When you shall eat of the fruit of your hands, you will be happy. And it will be well with you. Your wife shall be like a fruitful vine within your house. Your children like olive plants around your table. He describes a happy family. Behold, for thus shall the man be blessed who fears the Lord. So remember the Lord. Remember that God is for you. And if God is for me, who can be against me? As it says in Romans chapter 8. So I am coming up against the world, the flesh, and the devil. There is a real enemy out there who wants to steal and kill and destroy, and I remember the Lord who is awesome, and I fight. So we fight for the family, but we fight God's way and in the right way, and we know that God wants us to have a strong and godly family. Secondly, God wants us to face the fear and stand up to the enemy. Nehemiah said in verse 14, when I saw their fear, I arose and spoke to the nobles. They were afraid. You know, the Bible makes it clear that one of the things that the devil does to try and derail us, to try and get us to quit, is intimidation. He just steps up the intimidation. The devil uses intimidation. The devil uses discouragement. The devil uses lies to get us to quit. When I saw their fear, hey, let me ask you, in your marriage, in your family, what are you afraid of? What are you afraid of? Lots of men are afraid, if my wife really knew me, she wouldn't love me anymore. Because I've done some bad stuff. They're afraid to open up. I remember a man told me one time, he said in tears, he said, Jeff, if you really knew me, you wouldn't like me. The Apostle Paul was the chief of sinners. Can't be worse than him. He's the chief. Hey, you know what? If we just let our fears be known to our spouse, this is what I'm afraid of. I'm afraid you'd leave me. I'm afraid you wouldn't love me. Mom and Dad, I'm afraid that you would disown me if you knew the things that I did. My mom told me when she and my dad were having such trouble, separated for 2.5 years, she said with tears, she said, Jeff, I'm so afraid of growing old alone. What are you afraid of? God wants you to face your fear and stand up to the enemy. The enemy who is a liar and the father of lies. What did they say? They said they're going to come against you when you're not even ready. They're going to come and they're going to kill you. You need to abandon the work. But Nehemiah said, no, you remember the Lord who's great and awesome and you fight. So we remember the Lord who is great and awesome, and we remember that God will fight for us as we stand to fight. He's not going to fight for us when we hightail it to the tent. We say, oh, Lord, I can't do this. I'm just going to go back and play video games. And God says, hey, you need to engage with your spouse. You need to engage with your kids. You need to know the condition of your flocks and pay attention to your herds. You need to be all in with your family. Oh, God, I don't want to do that. You fight for me. And the Lord says, no, I won't do that. I will fight through you, but you have to show up. One of my favorite sayings, you've heard me say this before if you've been around the church for very long, God will not do what you can do, and you cannot do what he can do. God will not do what you can do, and you cannot do what he can do. God's not going to go out and put on his sword and shield and go fight Goliath. David had to do that, but God was going to give him the victory, something David couldn't do. You have to face your fear. Remember the Lord who is great and awesome, and fight. And as you fight, God will fight for you. Insight number three, the battle is tough, and the key is prayer and obedience. Prayer and obedience. Verse 8, and all of them conspired together to come and fight against Jerusalem and to cause a disturbance in it, but we prayed to our God. And because of them, we set up a guard against them day and night. We prayed, and then we acted. You know, you can do more than pray after you pray, but you can't do more than pray before you've prayed. And prayer is not your last resort. It's the first line of defense. We pray to discern God's plan and gain His strength. And then we must obey to see His glory. We obey to see God work. When Jesus was at the tomb of Lazarus in John chapter 11, He told Martha, roll away the stone. She said, Lord, he's been dead 4 days. He stinks. He said, did I not say to you, if you believe you will see the glory of God, roll away the stone. Do it. Jesus wasn't going to roll away the stone. God will not do what you can do. You cannot do what he can do. You roll away the stone, and when you roll away the stone, God's going to do what you can't do, and he's going to say, Lazarus, come forth, and he's going to perform a great miracle. But it requires your obedience. We must obey to see his glory, and we must never quit the fight. It's a fight for your family. It's a fight. And don't quit just because it's hard, just because the parenting doesn't seem to be working, just because your kid is still rebelling. Don't quit. It's always too early to quit. I'll close with this story. I have a friend of mine who is the host of Family Life Today on the radio, Bob Lapine. Bob has been in our church and has shared in our church in a men's group one night. Bob told this story to me. He said, my mom and dad had a rocky relationship. My dad drank, and he was bipolar. He probably also suffered from untreated PTSD because he was on the beach in Normandy and beyond. He said, one day I came home from college for Christmas, my sophomore year, and he said, my mom pulled me aside and said, Bob, I'm going to divorce your dad. Bob says, I'm not a particularly emotional guy, but I started to cry when she told me that. And she said to Bob, she said, Bob, why do you care? She said, you have your own life now. And Bob said he couldn't stop crying. He said, I don't know why I care, but I do. And he said this, he said, Jeff, I don't know if my tears made her change her mind that day, but she did. And they didn't divorce. And they were still together more than a decade later when Dad was diagnosed with malignant melanoma. By that time, he said he was sober through AA, and they'd been able to have some good years together. She was with him, caring for him all the way to the end. He said she later moved to a retirement community, and one day she told me this. She said, Bob, you know, I can tell the difference between the women here who are widows and the women who are divorcees. He said, what do you mean by that? She said, I can see it in their faces. There's a peace with the women who lost their husbands, but there's a hardness on the face of the women who have experienced a divorce. Bob says, I didn't say it to her then, but I often thought later. I'm so glad you have that peace. I know it was hard, but I'm so glad you and Dad stayed together.
Thanks so much for watching today. Listen, as we close the broadcast, I want to ask you this question. Do you know for certain that you belong to Jesus Christ? Do you know for certain that you've given your heart and life to Him? If not, today is the day for you. If you'll just pray this prayer from your heart, Lord Jesus, I need you. I know that I'm a sinner and I'm lost and I can't save myself. But Jesus, I believe that you're God in the flesh. I believe you died on the cross for my sins and rose again from the dead. I believe you're coming back in power and great glory. And right now, Jesus, I open my heart to you. Please forgive me of all my sins. Come and be my Lord and Savior. I surrender all to you. And I promise to follow you all the days of my life. My friend, if you'll pray that kind of prayer and mean it, the Lord will come in and your life will never be the same. I'd love to hear from you, to know that you're watching, to know that God is using this broadcast to make a difference in your life, to know that you just prayed that prayer to receive Christ as your Savior and Lord. Please take the time to call that toll-free number, write me, email me, let me know what's going on and how we can pray for you. You really are important to God, and you're important to us, and we're here for you.
Today's single message, Fighting for Your Family, is available in multiple formats when you contact us at 877-777-6171 or go online to fromhisheart.org. It's also one of seven in Pastor Jeff Shreve's inspiring and timely series entitled, We Are Family.
Hey, let's face it, parenting is tough. Navigating the obstacles we face as parents in this day and age of smartphones and social media and the sexual revolution is daunting to say the least. Now, without question, God's design for the family is under serious attack. And the big question is this, how can you have a great marriage and family and raise good and godly children in this environment? I believe my new seven-message series titled We Are Family can help. It's time for Christians to stand up and fight for their families, and that starts with you. The We Are Family series will give you practical and timely truth so you can honor God and experience His peace, love, and joy in your home.
This extraordinary seven-message series is our thanks for your gift of $30 or more to the ongoing outreach of From His Heart this month. It's available on USB flash drive, MP3 download, CDs, or DVDs. And when you give this month, we'll also send you Pastor Jeff and Debbie Shreve's popular booklet, I Still Do. Call 877-777-6171 or go online to fromhisheart.org and request the series, We Are Family. And thank you for impacting the kingdom of God through From His Heart. From His Heart is the viewer-supported broadcast ministry of Dr. Jeff Shreve, who believes that no matter how badly you may have messed up in life, God still loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life. You can find out more about that plan. Go to fromhisheart.org. Real truth.